That's the money shot there. It's super cool. So many different ways to strip a thread.
Welcome to Porsche.
A lot of aluminum.
Last time, Nate and Alex improved the factory G97 gearbox, getting rid of some over-engineered comfort items in favor of race car precision. Now it's time for the final steps. Get the engine and transmission mated and back in the car.
You know, before we get started with our starter, I'm gonna get started. These are from yesterday. We're popping a brand new Bosch starter in this guy just to make sure we know it's good and fresh. All right. It's gonna go like that. That's gonna go right there. Cayman engine harness. That's what looks like a good box to use. Oh boy. We got air pumps and wiring harnesses. Time to lay this all out and get ourselves organized. Next order of operations is this dang air pump. I'm not sure if we can delete it. I would love to. But remember, we're running the factory electronics on the car. So we gotta kind of keep it happy. We're gonna see how this fits. So we might actually have to pull the starter motor back off just so we can get this in, because this thing is going to fit like whop right in there, right here. This is what I think most people, this is the stage that a lot of people get really frightened of project cars. It's like where you have to like piece everything back together and like kind of double checking, not being afraid to take something back apart and seeing if you're right or you're wrong. Oh yes, that was the right play. So my big question is, do I run the harness through here now or do I wait? Let me look. We wait, most confidently, we wait. Because the harness comes through like this, but then goes outside. If it went under, I would have done it now.
In a car with a rear engine, you have to get the vacuum from the back of the car to the front of the car for your brake booster somehow. That's accomplished by this absolutely massive hose that is much taller than I am.
And runs the entire length
of the car. And runs the entire length of the car. Yeah. At the very end of it is like a 2mm, 3mm fitting, and that is what also distributes vacuum to the rest of the functions on the top of the motor. So basically, we have that open in the car. We need to plug it because we're no longer using the resonance valve, and we're also no longer using vacuum-assisted brakes. So we actually don't need this line anymore. We actually don't even need a vacuum pump, but we do need to figure out where that source is and make sure that we don't destroy the vacuum pump by leaving it open and or not plugged. And I believe it's that little brass fitting on the front of the motor, right?
So what would happen if we were to leave this open is it's gonna suck a bunch of air in here, build a bunch of crankcase pressure, and probably blow a little smoke out. So if we plug this up, it's just gonna pull vacuum on it, which is not gonna be a big deal. It'll just sit there pulling vacuum, and we just let it do its thing. So we just basically need to get from here to here.
And can we do that with...
I bet you could do it with this one. Or we can just steal the
ends. Just take this off and put a hose on this end and this end. There you go.
Nice.
So the way that I tend to do these, if you can't just pull them off, which those ones did, which is really cool, is you cut off, don't cut too short, because then you'll cut off everything, including the hose bar. But, and then what you can do is slip this in the backside, and actually if you only go in a couple millimeters, you can tear it off without damaging the hose barb. So, and then eventually you'll work your way down and you can take this off and reuse this fitting. Now, all we have to do is run a vacuum line from this hose barb to here, cap one of those, and we're done. And it'll also look way neater.
You guys know the trick to jump starting cars, right?
Tell us. Crickets perfect.
You guys know the secret to jumpstart cars, right? Literal cricket.
All right, so let's get this bracket back on here so we can lift this thing up, because pretty soon we're going to be lifting this whole engine onto that table right there with the gearbox, and two will become one, my favorite Spice Girls song.
I need some love like I never needed love before.
Gonna mate the transmission to ya. Had a little love, now I'm back for more. Gonna make the rotations go through ya.
How many days do we have left to build this car?
Is there anything else we're forgetting? Nope, let's get the wiring harness on this thing. I'm gonna do my best to clean this up without making it turn into a thing. I think I'm gonna be taking more stuff back out. I hate to say, I kind of figured out what parts of the harness went through the valley by how dirty they were. And if you ever wondered why people get so excited when they first start the car back up or whatever it is, this is why. Me and this M97 are friends now. We're buddies. We spend a lot of time together.
Shout out Porsche for giving us this. Also, how wild is it that basically the entire engine can be supported from two M8 bolts and that piece of steel?
Perfect, came right off the header, we're good. Set that down. Beautiful. Before we get into mating these two together, we have to pull this rear main seal out. So I'll show you some tricks on getting a main seal. You can see how recessed it is, it's gonna be pretty hard to get to. But before that, we're also gonna clean this up and get it ready. It does look like this rear main seal has been a little leaky. So I dig in there. I've done it with everything from a drywall screw to a constriction screw. Here we have some extra trim screws. And we're actually going to take this and we're literally going to poke a hole in the sheet metal in that seal and we're going to thread it in just a little bit. We're going to do the same thing on the other side. So you can see it's just feeding in. We want just a couple turns just to make sure we have some good engagement there. Prying against the hammer just to make sure we don't do any damage. There you go. And that is the screw trick. I always like to go back and just make sure that it didn't puncture through the inside, affecting the crankshaft at all, and didn't puncture the outside, affecting the case at all. So now we have two nice smooth areas. So you see that white thing that's kind of keeping it two sides right now? That's actually gonna slide over the nose of this crankshaft and allow us to slide this big O-ring on there carefully so we don't damage it in the process of installing it. Super important. And we're going to basically line it up there, clock it in place, hold this in, and I'm just gonna push this over with my fingers. And really the key is to get the seal on the snout of the crank safely without folding over the wrong way. And you can see, there we go, we have it. Now, the next thing we really wanna do is make sure that we get the seal in nice and straight. All right, so now we're flush, rear main seal installed. We'll wipe it down, make sure it's good to go. Boys at ASCO totally hooked us up. Jordan and gang over there make awesome flywheels and they're big Porsche guys as well. So super happy to put it on this car. And I'm also super happy to say we have it on the catalog now. So if that's something you guys want for your Porsche, go buy from them. Actually, sorry, buy from us, but we get it from them. Nah, whatever, doesn't really matter. It's so light, look at this. Pretty complicated flywheel to make. You'll see that we have the tone ring on it right here. So this is gonna go by this crank position sensor right here. That's right on the crank, and that's going to basically give the engine position at all times. So like, this is not a simple design. This is not a simple thing to make. Aluminum, steel ring, steel plate that's replaceable, so serviceable if need be. Proper pilot bearing already in there. Made in the USA, in California. So busy afternoon here at Espiro. DC is jamming, getting orders out to customers just like you. So we're gonna go in there, we're gonna weigh the difference between the ASCO flywheel and the stock dual mass flywheel and really show you what the difference actually is. Holy crap, this thing is heavy. Oh! All right, let's go. Lots of good stuff happening in here. Look at all these orders getting ready to go out. Oh, let's see what this thing weighs. All right, so 26 pounds. If we take that 0.5 back out of it, so we got a 26-pound flywheel. 12, 14-pound reduction of actual spinning mass. Not to mention, all that mass is closer to the center, so it's going to be, you know, less resistance to revving. So, killer stuff. Now we have this guy ready to go on. We have our dowel pin right here, so you can see our locator.
All right, so to clean this up, one thing you gotta remember is with aluminum flywheels, you always need a plate to distribute the load. Lock it down, buddy. Ready?
I'm here.
Holden.
That's
it. We have our pressure plate. So now we're gonna torque these suckers down. Your torque wrench is set to 19 foot-pounds, 27 newton meters. Cool. All right, let's mark them up and let's move forward. Reset back to zero. Keep those torque wrenches happy. All right, so it's in first gear. I got a couple helpers here. We're gonna lift this thing up, hopefully not push the engine off the edge of the table. So just be mindful of that, please. And then as soon as we get it close enough, we gotta watch this pin here. And obviously this pilot is going to go into the clutch. I have it in first gear so I can wiggle a little bit of drive into it to get it to line up nicely. It's going a little bit first up. Yep, that's it right there. Damn, son, some good product here. So we got some torque solution mounts. These things are nice and snuggy snug. So I'm gonna put some Loctite on here, thread this in, get them ready to go. Available on fcpeuro.com. So now that we took care of the rear mounting solution, it is time to take care of the front. Our friends over at Powerflex hooked us up with this. Really great solution for the front motor mount. Obviously you can see this is a pretty loosey-goosey guy. Allows a lot of movement back and forth. That's gonna slide through with a bunch of bushing grease on it so it doesn't like to squeak at us too much. And then on either side, we're gonna have the bolt plates that are gonna sandwich this whole thing in. Squeeze that together. We actually have to press this sucker out of here. Perfect. So we have a backing plate. This will allow the bushing to fall into it. And then we have a pressing plate. So this will sit on the outside edge of that bushing and allow me to push it out pretty easily. Oh man, it's tight. You hear the off-gassing? I have a feeling piecing this together is gonna be a little tricky. A little Powerflex job right here on the front. We'll mount this up to the car. We'll torque these suckers down. We'll make sure everything's good and tight. We're ready to install this thing.
The whole engine bay was covered in this absolutely awful insulation that just, I mean, it's like just falling apart. Today, we're gonna be replacing it with Thermo-tec Coolit sheeting, which is, it's an eighth inch thick. It's good for like 400 or 500 degrees on it and 2000 degrees radiant heat. So, and I'm just gonna basically fill in the Tetris puzzle that is the engine bay with Thermo-tec shielding. We'll be good to put the engine back in. So here is the finished result. This is, we actually ended up only using one 36 by 60 inch mat of the Thermo-tec stuff. Now we just have to work on getting the motor and trans back in here, but I think it actually turned out pretty nice. We'll lift the engine up. We will get to the transmission mounts right here.
Mm-hmm. The transmission's gonna come out like this. Let's put the PCV line on real quick.
Oh geez, yeah, let's get that on.
I don't know if there's stuff possibly bolted here.
Probably a couple.
All right, we're pretty centered over here. Maybe a little to the, a little this way.
Yeah.
A little more this way. A little more. All right, we're about good there. Now you get your tail end wherever you need to be. All right.
Right.
Just yell, everybody just yell if something looks like it's gonna make contact. Keep coming. All right, looks like the whole thing needs to move back maybe 5 inches. All right, stop. That makes sense. Just keep going real slow, real slow. All right, there, stop. One more. One more. Right there, stop. All right, up she blows. It's a good way to end the week.
That's the money shot there. That's super cool. So many different ways to strip a thread.
Welcome to Porsche.
A lot of aluminum.
This is gonna be a prime location for Alex to design the skid plate.
That was a long week.
That was a very long week, but
good work.
A proper week.
Yeah.
A lot of the smaller things have been done. A lot of things are in motion. Fingers crossed to keep our focus and we'll get there.
On the next episode, we're rewinding a little bit. Before the driveline was reinstalled, we had to start developing more efficient cooling. The Cayman wasn't originally intended for gravel and snow, so there's a lot to change to make the system robust and reliable. Next time, Alex dives into completely redesigning the cooling system and making this liquid-cooled Porsche rally-ready.